knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Next up in our survey of name reactions is the Ritter reaction. This one is named after John Ritter. No, wait, not the John Ritter who played Jack Tripper from Three's Company. We are talking about American chemist John Ritter, who reported his earliest results in 1948. It is an interesting reaction that achieves the hydration of a nitrile to an amide, with alkylation of the amide nitrogen by an alcohol. The products of this reaction are amides, which can be hydrolyzed to yield primary amines. This, therefore, indirectly constitutes a method to transform an alcohol into an amine. The reaction works best for tertiary alcohols, but can be applied to secondary and primary alcohols as well. The water is usually added at the end to quench the reaction. For tertiary alcohols, the mechanism is assumed to proceed as follows. First, the alcohol is protonated by the strong acid, which releases water and forms a tertiary carbocation. We know that carbocation stability follows the order tertiary, secondary, primary, so this is also their order of reactivity in the Ritter reaction. We have also seen that they tend to undergo isomerization via things like 1,2-hydride or methanide shifts, and this is also a potential side pathway in the Ritter reaction. The carbocation is attacked by the nitrile via the lone pair on the nitrogen, forming a nitrilium ion, and this can be written as the sum of two resonant structures. This intermediate is very electrophilic, and water will attack this carbon to form the amide. Now, we also know that stable carbocations can be obtained by protonation of highly substituted olefins, also known as alkenes. And indeed, another formulation of the Ritter reaction operates via olefins as substrates as follows. Again, the key intermediate is the carbocation, which is attacked by the nitrile to produce the expected amide product. And as we mentioned, hydrolysis of the amide can yield the primary amine. Of course, the Ritter reaction is not the main technique for making primary amines. We have already discussed other approaches, such as the Gabriel reaction. However, Ritter's original observation can be extended to modified applications that have a lot of value in organic synthesis. From this preliminary presentation, it will be easily understood that a nitrile can be a good nucleophile for carbocations, and there are many ways to generate these intermediates. Thus, instead of dehydrating an alcohol, we can use another method to generate a carbocation in the presence of a nitrile, and in principle, we may then produce useful extensions of the Ritter reaction. Let's examine a few examples that just scratch the surface of the potential this reaction may have. The drug Crixivan, introduced by Merck, was one of the first effective drugs against AIDS, and in the 1990s it attracted a huge amount of attention. Its structure is quite complex, and organic chemists were facing a tremendous challenge in trying to prepare ton amounts of the drug. The molecule contains 5 stereogenic centers. 2 of them are located in what was called the aminoindanol subunit, highlighted here in red. Therefore, one of the key problems was figuring out how to prepare this subunit in high regiochemical and stereochemical purity. One intermediate that was available in good enantiomeric purity was this indene epoxide, available from indene through enantioselective epoxidation, a reaction we will discuss in a future tutorial. The problem thus became, how do we go from this epoxide to the corresponding aminoindanol with regio and stereo control? The Merck chemists thought that the Ritter reaction would be a good candidate. The epoxide would open up to form a carbocation under acidic conditions. Of the 2 possible carbocations, this one seemed favored over the other because it is a benzylic carbocation and is thus stabilized by delocalization onto the benzene ring. It turns out that they were right, and the amination occurs only at the benzylic position, so the regiochemistry is all set. The other question was about the stereochemistry. If the amination is to be carried out with acetonitrile and subsequent hydrolysis, would the acetonitrile attack from the same face as the hydroxyl, which is the desired outcome, or the opposite face? It turns out that the attack was only carried out from the same side as the alcohol, allowing the isolation of this oxazoline, which can then be hydrolyzed to give the desired product in very high yield. So where does the stereoselectivity come from? It turns out that the attack of the nitrile onto the carbocation, or the formation of the nitrilium ion, is reversible, and when we operate in the absence of water, there are no nucleophiles to capture the nitrilium ion other than the adjacent hydroxyl group. If the trans nitrilium ion is formed, attack is hindered because of the strain that would result, since the groups are on opposite sides of the ring. The cis nitrilium ion, on the other hand, quickly and irreversibly snaps shut to form the oxazoline due to the proximity of the groups, and that is how the problem was solved. We will finish up with a more advanced application, which was just published in 2021 by Professor Babak Borhan at Michigan State University. The goal was the amido chlorination of certain olefins with complete enantio and regio control, and this example here works particularly well. The plan is to create a chiral chlorinium ion, as is shown here, by the addition of a chlorinium ion source to the olefin from the stereoface dictated by a chiral ligand. This chiral chlorinium ion would then be the source of the carbocation for acetonitrile to attack. The chlorinating agent that worked best was dichlorodimethylhydantoin, or DCDMH. Attack of the acetonitrile antide to the chlorine atom at the carbon yielding the more stable carbocation would lead to the product. The idea worked perfectly well. The ideal catalyst was found by screening, and it turned out to be DHQD2-PHAL, a derivative of quinine, and this yielded 98-99% EE for most substrates, which means complete enantioselectivity. The regioselectivity was also essentially complete, and only one isomer out of four possible ones was obtained in high yield. The amount of catalyst required was only 1 mole%. This example brings us to the state of the art in Ritter chemistry. As you can see, chemists can now combine old reactions with new methodologies, such as enantioselective organocatalysis, to execute sophisticated, highly selective operations. The field of enantioselective organocatalysis was recently recognized with the Nobel Prize for Chemistry to Professors List and McMillan. Thus, even today, the Ritter reaction continues to inspire chemists at the forefront of science to create new useful reactivities and products.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.